And after one to begin with, we're going to be discussing Christ is coming to bring an end to this world. I like the way Lee kind of worded there. He says, Travis will be speaking, Christ is coming, and he'll bring an end to this world. I'm not bringing the end to this world. No worries. All right, Genesis chapter 1. We'll begin in the beginning. Oh, no. Lee. Ah, ha, 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 ha. Amen. There's nothing worse than looking at the text and not seeing the text. All right. Try this again. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth, and the earth was formless and void, and darkness was over the surface of the deep, and the Spirit of God was moving over the surface of the waters. Then God said, Let there be light, and there was light. And God saw the light was good, and God separated the light from the darkness. And God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, one day. Now verse 26. Then God said, Let us make man in our image, according to our likeness, and let them rule over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the sky, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth. And God created man in his own image. In the image of God he created him. Male and female he created him. And God blessed them, and God said to them, Be fruitful and multiply, and fill the earth, and subdue it, and rule over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the sky, and over every living thing that moves on the earth. Then God said, Behold, I have given you every plant yielding seed that is on the surface of all the earth, and every tree which has fruit yielding seed. It shall be food for you. And to every beast of the earth, and to every bird of the sky, and to everything that moves on the earth which has life, I have given every green plant for food. And it was so. And God saw all that he had made, and behold, it was very good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the sixth day. God created the heavens and the earth. And it establishes right from the beginning that everything was good. I think at all the things that I try to create, and I love to work with my hands. I like to build, to make furniture, to build tables, work around the house and repair little things. And I look at it and sometimes I say, that's not good. I'm not perfect as our Lord. None of us are. We're made perfect through his blood. We're made sinless through his blood. But God created the world and it was good. And he put us in charge over all of it. He said to subdue it, to have the world in subjection to us. And he told us to multiply and to fill the earth. When I think about this topic, and I think about the end in particular, I've had a lot of experiences arguing, I guess, about what the end is. I've been blessed to have a lot of discussions with folks who believe the end of the world was in 70 AD, in which case, welcome to heaven. That would be their approach. I've talked to a great number of Jehovah's Witnesses. And it seems like, as I have these conversations, it's not the same routine. I mean, you're not always covering the same stuff. There's always something more that's being brought out. You might think, okay, I've got an argument for X, but then there'll be a Y defense. And it bothers me, I guess, that at times when we have these discussions with folks, that for them and for us, we try to play gotcha. I don't like gotcha. Because I try to invite folks into my home and say, hey, you're welcome here. Share with me what you've got. And I'll share with you what I've got looking at Scripture. And we'll try to come to what the Scriptures say in a proper understanding together. It's difficult to have that attitude. And I'll be guilty, and my kids continually bring it up. I literally had some folks run from the house once, to my shame. We have to be good and we have to be kind. Now, when we talk about the end, Again, there's some folks believe 70 AD. There are other folks that will say, well, the end is going to come before a 1,000-year reign of Christ upon the earth. And then there are some folks who just say there will be no end. And so really, as we look at the topic today, we're going to have to establish that the earth is indeed going to end. And of course, according to the topic two, we're going to have to determine that it is Christ bringing that end. I believe that God created this world. We've read that there in Genesis. I believe that as we look at Scripture, that we will see Christ coming in the clouds. And I believe there's only one coming in the clouds. And I will stand on the fact that I believe any reference to Jesus coming in the clouds has to do with his final judgment and the end of the world. Now, we're going to look at a couple of passages, or at least we'll mention a couple of passages, where folks don't see that. I can only give you what I've studied. That's all I can do. There are a lot of perhaps controversial verses as I went over this topic that I thought, okay, I could use this or that. And I've really tried to avoid them because I'm not sure the purpose. I think we can accomplish our sermon topic in general with avoiding a lot of conflicting or not conflicting, a lot of controversial items. But I struggled with this. Usually you give me a topic and I get it done pretty early. I worked on this till 3 o'clock yesterday, this morning. And then I laid in bed thinking for about 45 minutes, which was just peachy. So what I'm going to show you is something I've put some time in, I've put some thought in, and I told Lee I may not even use all my time because I shortened it enough that I hope we can get there. Now, I may be wrong, and this may turn out way over my time, in which case, no big deal, Lee speaks after me. So we're going to look at the eternal earth, and we're going to look at its proponents. First off, we have to ask, what is the purpose of the earth, and what is the purpose of man? If you're looking at folks that are proponents, that is, they say there is an eternal earth, that's what they believe. I'm not affirming that, but I am going to go over some of the verses that they will bring up. Now, purpose of the earth, they'll go to Isaiah 45 and 18. Now, this is typically for speaking about Jehovah's Witnesses, although there are others that do the same. Isaiah 45 and 18, "For thus saith the Lord that created the heavens, God himself that formed the earth and made it. He hath established it. He created it not in vain." In other words, his will was not empty. "He formed it to be inhabited. I am the Lord, and there is none else." When we look at this passage, the argument is the purpose of the earth's creation was to be inhabited. God's purpose is never vain. We're going to talk about that in a moment. But because it was created to be inhabited, if it ended, then its purpose would not be fulfilled, and therefore it cannot end, according to that argument. The purpose of man, Genesis 1:28, "And God bless him, God said unto them, be fruitful, multiply, fill the earth, subdue it, have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the fowl of the air, and over every living thing that moveth upon the earth." When we read this, is it man's function to fill the earth? And the truth is, if we look at these verses, is it our function to fill the earth and to care for animals? And then we're done. Was the earth created for man, or is man created for the earth? That's really the type of argument that we've got going on. A further question I think you have to ask is, if we go and we build a home. We build a home, and the purpose is we're building a home so someone can inhabit it, right? And so they live there. And they've done that. What happens when they move and go somewhere else? Is that house now a waste? Or did it serve its purpose? We have to consider that when we look at the earth and whether or not it is eternal. I want to talk also about God's power and his plan. Again, we're talking about the proponents' arguments here. If you would, let's turn to Isaiah 46. We'll read verses 9 through 11. Isaiah 46, begin there in verse 9. Now verse 9, we look through verse 11. "Remember the former things long past, for I am God and there is no other. I am God and there is no one like me, declaring the end from the beginning and from ancient times things which have been done, saying, my purpose will be established. I will accomplish all my good pleasure, calling a bird of prey from the east, a man of my purpose from a far country. Truly I have spoken, truly I will bring it to pass. I have planned it, surely I will do it. Isaiah 55:11, so shall my word be that goeth forth out of my mouth. It shall not return unto me void. This is the Lord speaking. But it shall accomplish that which I please, and it shall prosper in the thing where I sent it. My thought in regard to the proponent's argument there, and again, as I go through these things, I try to ask myself questions. And anytime anybody presents something to us, we need to ask ourselves questions. Is what they're saying possible? Is what I'm saying, could it be an error? Or is there just something I haven't thought of? So, as I'm kind of going through my thoughts, I think of 1 Corinthians 2:11, and we're talking about God's purpose and His plan. 1 Corinthians 2:11 says, for what man knoweth the things of man, save the spirit of man which is in him? So, my spirit, in there, I know in general what I'm thinking. Of course, the fact is, at times, I may not even have the words to express that, in which my Lord would interpret that. But we go beyond that. Finishing that verse, even so the things of God knoweth no man, but the Spirit of God. So we don't know what God thinks. Only the Spirit of God knows, unless it's in the written word. Deuteronomy 29:29 talks about the secret things of God, the things we're just not going to know. So when we're talking about God's power, about God's plan, for me, I don't doubt God's power. And I don't doubt that when He says He has a plan, God will accomplish it. There's no question in my mind about it. But the thing about it is, I don't know His full plan. I see parts and bits of it. It's like the mystery that the prophets spoke of long beforehand. They didn't understand God's full plan about their salvation until, of course, it was revealed to them, and we see that in the New Covenant, in the New Testament. So there's some things that I have pieces of. And so I kind of guess, well, is this God's plan? Is it not? Do I doubt His power? Do I doubt His ability when He says it's going to happen? That it's going to happen? No, I don't doubt that at all. But because God wanted the earth inhabited, I'm struggling with that word today, inhabited, doesn't tell me that He wants it to exist forever. It just tells me He wanted someone to dwell there. Now, there are a number of scriptures here that are used to establish that the earth will last eternally. Psalm 37:29, the righteous shall inherit the land and dwell therein forever. The land, also, that term can be earth, and it's used that way by different eternal earth proponents. Psalm 104:5, who laid the foundations of the earth that it should not be moved forever? So then again, we have what appears to some as the earth never moving, it being there continually. Psalm 148:3-6, praise ye Him, sun and moon, praise Him, all ye stars of light, praise Him, ye heaven of heavens, and ye waters that are above the heavens. Let them praise the name of Jehovah, for He commanded, and they were created. He hath also established them forever and ever. So what was established forever and ever? Well, He says there that the heavens, they were established forever and ever, and then He continues. He says, He commanded them, they were created. Oh, excuse me. Let them praise the name of Jehovah. He commanded they were created. He had established them forever and ever. He had made a decree which shall not pass away. Psalm 78:69. And He built His sanctuary like high places, like the earth which He hath established forever. And Ecclesiastes 1:4. One generation passeth away, another generation cometh, but the earth abideth forever. Now, someone comes and sits you and says, look, here's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 verses that say the earth is lasting forever. You need to have a response. And that can keep people off guard, because in the church we're used to saying, oh, yeah, we're going to a different place and the earth is going to be done and destroyed. And we've been taught that and it's in our mind, but we can't necessarily prove that. We're going to try to do that today. Now, my thoughts on these type of things are these verses set forth, which something that looks like it's a concrete argument about the earth lasting eternally. But we've got to look at the whole counsel of God. 2 Timothy 3:16-17, which we've quoted a number of times, talking about the scripture being inspired by God. So it's from God. And 2 Peter 1:20-21, it says, it's not from our mind. Again, it's from God. And John 17:17, which I think is so critical in teaching any Christian or any person who might become a Christian, John 17:17, sanctify them in truth, thy word is truth. If the word is true, if it is truth, it does not contradict. So we've got to look at the whole picture here. And thus far, if we just go by the proponent's argument, okay, the earth is going to last forever. But remember, we're just kind of looking and asking ourselves questions. When we study and we look, we have to understand that our understanding comes from study. 2 Timothy 2:15. And we study to show ourselves approved unto God. Workmen who need not be ashamed, handling accurately the word of truth. So we've got to get into the word and we've got to be able to stand on it. We have to look at context. We have to look at the audience. We have to look at the type of language, whether it's figurative or literal. And we have to look at time frames as well. Certainly there are other things I'm certain folks can imagine that we have to look at in the scriptures. But the key really is consider all things to make sure we've got it right. We've got to rely on words too. And when we talk about words, we've got to understand their meanings. Does the term earth and forever or always, do they have the same meaning every single time? And for that matter, in regard to our topic, does the term end have the same meaning every time? Now, I had proposed so much material that I was going to examine that specific topic or all those items for you, but I really don't want to break it down to all those different words because I think, again, we can come to our conclusion in a simpler way. Continuing on this idea of the eternal earth proponents, I do want to look at a couple of words. In all of these five or six verses that I read you that are given to us to say that the earth was eternal, there are one or two or both words used in every passage for forever. And that is the term olam, which is Hebrew. And if you look in the Brown Driver Briggs or some sort of lexicon to look at the words, and by the way, it's great. Well, I use eSword electronically. David uses something really super powerful and muscled. I don't know what it is. It's a really good program, okay? It's great to get electronic programs as lexicons. But get one that's exhaustive. The one I have in eSword is not. And so when I go in eSword and I look up this Olam H576 and I see it says forever. Well, great. That doesn't tell me anything other than what the verses I said, which is the earth is Olam or it's forever. And that puts me in the thing going, okay, it's going to last. But when you get an exhaustive concordance or exhaustive lexicon, it gives you a lot more idea about how a word is used. It gives you more detail. Now, not only is this olam used, but odd, A-D. It's an odd spelling. But it's from the 85703. Don't shake your head, Lee. Odd. So we've got this odd term. Now, we look at these words, what do they mean? I want to look at both these words, which supposedly mean forever, but I want to look at their uses in Scripture. Now, if they always mean forever, great. We're not going to question what we've looked at. But I suggest to you they don't always mean forever. And an exhaustive lexicon will show us that. Let's look at Leviticus 24 and 9. Leviticus 24 and verse 9. Okay, there in verse 9, and I know some of you are afraid to turn your pages around with me because you went so fast yesterday, Travis, we didn't think we'd keep up with you today, but you will for the most part, I promise. Now, verse 9, we're speaking about the sanctuary, and the temple sanctuary. As is, and it shall be for Aaron and his sons, and they shall eat it in a holy place. Of course, this is talking about the shewbread. For it is most holy to him, for the Lord's offerings by fire, his portion forever. So it's talking about sacrifices here, really. Sacrifices forever. Do they do that anymore? No. Because the law is done with, isn't it? So they don't do it anymore. And that word there is olam. So when we're looking at that, we can see that sometimes that forever actually means as far as you can see. Or for that duration of time. Another one is 2 Chronicles chapter 2 and verse 4. 2 Chronicles 2, there in verse 4. In this passage, we're talking about Solomon. and Solomon building a temple. There in verse 4, "Behold, I am about to build a house for the name of the Lord my God, dedicating it to him, to burn fragrant incense before him, and to set up the shewbread continually, and to offer burnt offerings morning and evening, on Sabbaths and on new moons, and on the appointed feasts of the Lord our God, this being required forever in Israel." So again, he also talks about the sacrifices, but he's building this temple, and it's, if they're going to offer the sacrifices forever, a temple's got to be there forever. It's not. So once again, Olam being extending out for a period as far as they could see, but not necessarily forever. So now we've got doubt on those scriptures that were brought to us at the beginning. I want to look at the word odd now. Odd often is used as a cognate of the verb adah. They'll both be used. It's used as a form of that word. You know, we look at our different tenses, and I guess probably that's the best way to describe it. We've got future, past, present, and it's that simple. It's not that simple necessarily in Hebrew or Greek or whatever, and I'm not a Greek scholar. I'm sure, well, Lee, I guarantee, could tell you a whole lot more than I know about this. But I do know a little bit, and we can use the lexicons. You don't have to be a genius to do these things. The lexicon will tell you where to look, and you just read the verse and use our common sense on a lot of this. Job 20 and 4. Looking at the word odd. There in verse 20, now looking at verse 4. "Do you know this from of old, from the establishment of man on earth?" Travis, I don't see a forever in there. Why is that? That's because the word odd in this case is the word old. It's actually talking about the past. So now we know it's not infinite past because it was of things that were created. So again, we're looking at a specific time frame. Let's take a look one more verse in regard to the Psalm 132, there verses 13 through 14. Psalm 132:13-14. "For the Lord has chosen Zion; he has desired it for his habitation." Now Zion, Temple Mount Zion, Jerusalem. Okay? So for the Lord has chosen Jerusalem, if you would, Zion. "He has desired it for his habitation. This is my resting place forever. Here I will dwell, for I have desired it." That certainly didn't last forever, didn't it? Because we can actually go and see that the Lord departed from that. His spirit certainly departed from the temple. And then, of course, he would destroy Jerusalem as well. So, we see a limitation on these words. Because, and this is important, and I've got to say this right, but because there are alternative solutions, we cannot be certain of the eternal earth conclusions. In other words, if there's an alternative, you can't be certain of your solution. And we'll repeat that as we go. Now, there are verses that I believe that we're going to look at now, because we're going to step away from pro-eternal earth. There are verses that are going to show that will demonstrate that the earth is not going to last forever, which opens up the possibility that Christ comes and puts an end to the world, which leads to a very interesting story of why I stayed up from 2 a.m. to 3 a.m. because I had an epiphany that shocked me, and I was like, oh, this is a bad time to have a new idea. But we'll get to that. So, I want to look at Christian faith for a moment. I've said this already in my earlier lesson, Romans 10:17, our faith comes from the Word. That's where it originates. John 1 and 1 and 2, 3 establishes that the Word was in the beginning. The Word was God. All things he created came into being because of the Word, because of Christ, right? So the Word created what we see. So when we go to Romans 1 and 20, we see that those things that he created, the evidences lead us forth to establish that there is a God. Now, whether we seek him or not and fulfill that promise in Matthew 7:7, seeking will find, is up to us. But I suggest to you that part of the Word is what he has created, that is creation, and therefore our faith can come from that as well. It leads us to the Word, the written Word. Now, the evidence of Scripture, 2 Timothy, going back, 2 Timothy 3:16-17, all scriptures inspired, suitable for doctrine. That word reproof, I just absolutely hate the English of that, because that word means evidence. Because we don't need rebuke. Rebuke and correction, same thing, okay? It's evidence
and correction and instruction in righteousness. So we've got evidence there in 2 Timothy 3:16, 17. But there's another verse, Hebrews 11:1. Faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction. No. The evidence. It's the same exact word as in 2 Timothy 3:16, 17. The evidence of things not seen. So we have in here faith being the assurance of things hoped for, the evidence. Okay, so we've got evidence of our hope, though we can't see it. Now, what am I hoping? I am hoping not to stay on this ball the rest of my life. I am hoping for something better that I cannot see, an eternal home in the heavens. Some will say, again, the 780 doctrine proponents will say, this is heaven. I'm saying, no, please, no. Because I can't see my hope, which is an eternal heaven. And the evidence is in Scripture, and the creation prompts me, as part of the Word, it prompts me to find that evidence. Faith is not blind. Don't fool ourselves. That's not what Hebrews says. Faith is built on evidence. It's built on proof. And that's why we have the Word to bring us to that understanding. So, what home do I have faith in? Colossians chapter 1, verses 3 through 5. Colossians 1, 3 through 5. Now, Paul is writing the Colossians here, and the Colossians are Jews, of course, right? No, they're not Jews. And I say that because it's very important to realize your audiences, because there's a great number of folks that talk about judgment and the end and think it's all Jerusalem-centric or all Jew-centric, and that's not the case. But there in Colossians, Colossians chapter 1, verses 3 through 5. We give thanks to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, praying always for you, since we heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and the love which you have for all the saints, because of the hope laid up for you where? In heaven, of which you previously heard the word of truth, the gospel. So we have a heaven at the moment, a place that they're hoping for, something they can't see, a non-Jewish audience. Let's go further on. 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 5. Yes, I'm speeding up a little bit, and I probably will a tad. 1 Peter, now chapter 1, verses 3 through 5 as well. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his great mercy has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to obtain an inheritance which is imperishable, is eternal, can't be destroyed, and undefiled and will not fade away, reserved in heaven for you, who are protected by the power of God through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. If it's not revealed yet, that's heaven, and that's our inheritance, something we can't see. There is our hope. Matthew chapter 5, verse 12. Matthew 5, verse 12. Rejoice, our Lord speaking. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward in heaven is great, for so they persecuted the prophets who were before you. Matthew 6, verses 19 and 20, do not lay up for yourselves treasures upon earth, where moth and rust destroy, where thieves break it and steal, but lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust destroys, where thieves do not break it or steal, for where your treasure is, there will your heart also be. My heart is where my hope is, where the evidence is, which points to heaven. Heaven's not here. That's my home. Is the purpose of earth not going to be fulfilled because I'm moving on? Because I'm a sojourner here? You have to answer that question in your mind. Matthew chapter 19, verse 21 now. Looking at verse 21, Jesus said to him, if you wish to be complete, go and sell your possessions, give to the poor, you shall have treasure in heaven. 2 Corinthians 5, verse 1, for we know that if the earthly house of our tabernacle be dissolved, we have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. That's to the Corinthians. That's not to the Jews. Now, I'm not saying there weren't some Jewish Christians there, but that's important to know. Matthew 6:10, the kingdom come, thy will be done, as in heaven, so on earth. Christ just pointed out two different places. There's heaven, and there's earth. My hope, my inheritance, as a son of God, as an heir, is in heaven. One is my eternal home, and one is not.
My faith simply hopes for what I cannot see. 2 Corinthians 4:18. While we look not at the things which are seen, but the things which are not seen. Oh, listen to this so very closely. Because this is the unraveling. This is the unraveling of the eternal earth argument in one single verse. For the things which are seen are temporary. Y'all see the earth? Yeah. Even if we're blind, we feel the earth. We can smell the soil. We can smell the pollution. We can smell the pine trees. We can hear the birds. Our five senses establish it's here. We can see it. But that which we can see is temporary. But the things which are not seen are eternal. Oh, look at 1 Corinthians 15. 15, we're going to look at verse 35 and we're going to go through 54. 1 Corinthians 15. Now looking at verse 35. But someone will say, how are the dead raised? And with what kind of body do they come? You fool, that which you sow does not come to life unless it dies. And that which you sow, you do not sow the body which is to be, but a bare grain, perhaps of wheat or of something else. But God gives it a body just as he wishes, and to each of the seeds a body of its own. All flesh is not the same flesh. But there is one flesh of men, another flesh of beasts, another flesh of birds, another of fish. There are also heavenly bodies and earthly bodies, but the glory of heaven is one, and the glory of the earth is another. There is one glory of the sun, and another glory of the moon, and another glory of the stars, for the stars differ from stars in glory. So also is the resurrection of the dead. It is sown a perishable body. It is raised an imperishable body. Our flesh, that which you see, is going away. It is sown in dishonor, it is raised in glory, it is sown in weakness, it is raised in power, it is sown in natural body, it is raised a spiritual body. With all of our senses, we cannot see nor detect the spirit. If there is a natural body, there is also a spiritual body. So it is written, the first man, Adam, became a living soul. The last Adam became a life-giving spirit. However, the spiritual is not first, but the natural, then the spiritual. The first man is from earth, earthly. The second man is from heaven. As is the earthly, so also those who are earthy. As is the heavenly, so also those who are heavenly. Just as we have borne the image of the earthly, so we shall bear the image of the heavenly. Verse 50. Now I say this, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we shall be changed. For this perishable must put on the imperishable. This mortal must put on immortality. But when the perishable will have put on the imperishable, and this mortal will have put on immortality, then will come about the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. Philippians 3:20, our citizenship is in heaven. Hebrews 11:13 through 16, what was Abraham looking for? What were the patriarchs looking for? They were looking for a city not upon this earth. They were looking for a city that is built for God, a heavenly city which God hath prepared. They were looking for something beyond this big ball. They expected something beyond this big ball, this earth. That's not where their hope lied. They were looking for something that they could not see. That was where their hope was. What we see is temporary. It will be destroyed. The earth is going to end. The possibility of an alternative eliminates the certainty of a solution. Psalm 102, 25 through 27. Of old thou hast laid the foundation of the earth, and the heavens are the work of thy hands. They shall perish, but thou shalt endure. Yea, all of them shall wax old like a garment. As a vesture shalt thou change them. They shall be changed, but thou art the same, and thy years shall have no end. Now, a lot of folks will say, well, they're changed. It's going to become something new. The earth will stay. It'll be this perfect spiritual place. That's not the kind of change we're talking about. We're talking about the taking off. We're talking about the putting away of it. Mark chapter 13, verse 31. Heaven and earth shall pass away, but my word shall not pass away. Some will look at that passage, and they will try to break it up, specifically 70-80 doctrine inheritance, though not everybody who holds that view would also agree with that passage. There are some in the church that will simply say this involves only Jerusalem and the old and the new law. I suggest to you that that is not the case here, but the earth is going to be passed away. We have that from our Lord. 2 Peter 3, though. 2 Peter 3:13, and this verse is important, and it's important to break it up. I have my glasses on backwards again. Goofiest thing ever. 2 Peter chapter 3, we're now going to read verses 3 through 13. Now beginning verse 3. Know this first of all, that in the last days, mockers will come with their mocking, following after their own lusts, and saying, where is the promise of his coming? For ever since the fathers fell asleep, all continues just as it was from the beginning of creation. Because these things were supposed to be coming shortly. I'm going to disagree and say that when we say these things which are about to shortly pass or occur is the beginning of that. This lectureship was shortly to begin, and it was coming shortly for me. And here it is, and it wasn't over in a moment, but it took time. And I would suggest when we look at the beginning of Revelation that we're looking at the beginning of a dispensation. But that's, again, for your own study. We continue on. He says, verse 5, for when they maintain this, it escapes their notice that by the word of God the heavens existed long ago, and the earth was formed out of water and by water, through which the world at that time was destroyed, being flooded with water. Did the earth completely go away, or was it destroyed with the flood? No. The people were, though. The world being the people. And this is one of those terms that is important to understand. It can have different meanings. That is the world. But the present heavens and earth, by his word, are being reserved for fire, kept for the day of judgment and destruction of ungodly men. But do not let this one fact escape your notice, beloved, that with the Lord one day is 1,000 years, 1,000 years is one day. The Lord is not slow about his promises, some count slowness, but is patient toward you, not wishing for any to perish, but for all to come to repentance. Verse 10. But the day of the Lord will come like a thief. And, of course, we've had this discussed already, and I thought it was covered very well. In which the heavens will pass away. The heavens, we're speaking of all those elemental heavens, both the atmosphere and the heavens that we see, where the stars, the planets, so forth are. They'll pass away with the roar, and the elements. Now, we talked about what I would have shared with the kids, the elements, the gases, the things we don't see, all the way down to the electrons, the protons, the ions, so forth. The elements, those will go away. What composes everything physical here will go away. The visible, that detected by our senses or our aided eye, will go away. They'll be destroyed with the intense heat. And the earth, this is not the people in this case. This is speaking of the physical earth. This is the word being used in this case. And its works will be burned up. Since all these things are to be destroyed in this way, what sort of people are you be in holy conduct and godliness, looking for and hastening the coming of the day of God, on account which the heavens will be destroyed by burning, the elements will melt with intense heat. Again, we have a reinforcement of those elemental things. You're going to hear arguments in your life saying that's the old law or the new covenant or whatever. That's not what's going on here. But according to his promise, we are looking for a new heavens and a new earth in which righteousness dwells. And of course, you could go to Isaiah 65 and we could bring up different things. Let me suggest this, a changing of environment, not necessarily a physical earth. So we cover that. We look at the elements. We look at the heavens and earth to be destroyed differently than the flood, which was the world, which was the people. These verses eliminate the possibility that the eternal earth verses mean forever, because it specifically addresses the physical earth and the physical surroundings and the elements thereof. And it says they will be destroyed. There's no question about that aspect because of the words earth there and the elements of it. The earth is going to end. Now Christ is coming. He is coming to end the world. The coming of Christ in the clouds. I will suggest you again, clouds, cloud, every single reference with Jesus in the clouds has to do with the end, with the exception of the ones I'm going to mention. Okay? Acts 1, 9 through 11, Christ ascends in the clouds. It said he's going to come back the same way. Clearly not his second coming because he's leaving. Daniel 7, 13 through 14, we read in my other lesson. Christ comes in the clouds to the throne of God. It's a heavenly scene.
Revelation 1:7, though. Revelation 1:7 and the other verses, all of the verses, I believe, deal with his second coming. And I don't believe there are any other comings. I don't believe Jerusalem was a coming. And I don't believe we can say that Christ came in the clouds in Jerusalem. Now that may go right in the face of what a lot of people read in Matthew 24 and Mark 13 and some understandings of Luke 17 or 21. But I will hold to that position. Revelation 1:7, behold, he come with the clouds, and every eye shall see him, and they that pierced him, and all the tribes of the earth shall mourn over him. Even so, amen. He's coming, every eye will see him. I will suggest you, and I will demonstrate to you briefly, because I know I'm running out of time quickly now. Hey, I filled the time, Lee. We're talking about the resurrection. He's coming back for that. Matthew 24, 29 through 31, Mark 13, 24 through 27 are parallel. I believe they deal with the second coming as well and the resurrection. Matthew 26 and 64, Mark 14 through 62, Christ is speaking to Caiaphas. He tells them they will see him coming in the clouds. In that circumstance, history absolutely 100% proves that Caiaphas died before 7 AD, so it absolutely could not have been at that point in time. So that leaves us again an end of world, a resurrection, pulling Caiaphas out of the ground so that he could see that as well as everyone else. Now, there's one other specific verse referencing Christ's final return in the clouds. It's 1 Thessalonians 4:13 through 18. We'll examine that in a brief moment. Though there are other verses discussing God and the clouds, I would suggest there are none others that I've ever seen with Jesus and the clouds, and those all, with the exception of what we noted, again, will refer to the second coming and the resurrection. So here's what got me last night. I get to this point, I say, Christ is coming to end the world. And everything we've looked at, we've looked and said, okay, yeah, the world's going to end. The things that we can see, they're going to end. And we've seen, absolutely, Christ is coming back. There's no question about that, and we've had that throughout this lectureship. He's coming back. But I couldn't find a single verse that said Christ is going to destroy the world. And at 2 o'clock in the morning, I'm like, how can you have a lesson saying Christ is coming to end the world and you don't have a single verse saying that? And maybe the wiser, older minds, and I mean that seriously, or younger minds, somebody's run across it where I haven't seen it. So I'm like, I've got to tie that and find that. And so this is what I did. Paul speaks to Felix. Acts 24, 14 through 15. But this I confess unto thee, that after the way which they call heresy, so worship I the God of my fathers, believing all things which are written in the law and the prophets. I have hope toward God, which they themselves also allow, that there shall be a resurrection of the dead, both the just and the unjust. It is a single resurrection of the just and the unjust. It is not a plural resurrections. There is one resurrection. So Christ is coming back for the resurrection of man. Paul believes in that. Now we're going to read these verses that we've covered a number of times in this lectureship, and it's unavoidable. We must go back and we must see this. 1 Thessalonians 4:13 through 18. In this passage, verse 13, but we do not want you to be uninformed, brethren, about those who are asleep, that you may not grieve, as do the rest of us have no hope. For if we believe Jesus died and rose again, even so God will bring with him those who have fallen asleep in Jesus. For this we say to you by the word of the Lord, we who are coming, or we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord, shall not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds, because that's how he's returning, to meet the Lord in the air, because he's not coming to the earth. He's not establishing a thousand-year kingdom. And thus we shall always be with the Lord. Therefore, comfort one another through these words. So in this passage, it speaks of Christ's return in the clouds, as we said, and it ties him to the resurrection. Now, 2 Thessalonians, across the page for me, chapter 1, verse 6 through 10. For after all, it is only just for God to repay with affliction those who afflict you, to give relief to those who are afflicted and to us as well, when the Lord Jesus shall be revealed from heaven with his mighty angels in flaming fire, dealing out retribution to those who do not know God and to those who do not obey the gospel of our Lord Jesus. And these will pay the penalty of eternal destruction away from the presence of the Lord and from the glory of his power when he comes, to be glorified in the saints on that day and to be marveled at among all who have believed, for our testimony to you was believed. So, we have here punishment of the ungodly tied to the resurrection, which gives me the final verse Which by necessary inference, by pulling all together God's statements, his implications, I can infer that Christ is coming to the end of the world. We go to 2 Peter chapter 3, and we're only going to read verse 7. 2 Peter chapter 3, and there in verse 7. But the present heavens and earth, by his word, are being reserved for fire, kept for the day of judgment and destruction of ungodly men. The last verse that we just read said that resurrection would deal with the judgment of the ungodly. There's one resurrection. There's one coming. It's a coming in the clouds. And Christ is coming to end the world. The earth is not eternal. Our home, our eternal home, is in heaven. And again, he will. Christ is coming to bring an end to this world.